you know, whenever you start, and then, you know, you just, when you begin, we just take.
Yeah. So we are live now. Good evening, all. I think we're meeting after quite a long time, but it's a good occasion to have Lalit Achani with us. Hi, Lalit.
Hi there. Hi, Nachi.
Thanks for having me. Thank you for joining. And maybe for people who are watching it for the first time, I think, Lalit, if you can yourself tell a little bit about your work, your practice, and a little bit.
Okay.
From
okay.
your, I'd like to hear from yourself.
Okay. So I'm Lalit Vashani, and I teach at the Center for Modern Indian Studies at the University of Göttingen, which is where I'm speaking from right now. And these are the films you're going to see, or which Nachi has very kindly and Potato Eaters Collective have very kindly agreed to host for this period of time, are two films on the RSS and a film that follows the trail of Gandhi's Salt March. A lot of my interests in documentary are in the sort of the field of political ethnography. And I'm interested in issues of Hindu nationalism and looking at the RSS and studying the RSS. And of course, the idea of following Gandhi's Salt March was also, it was Gandhi's Salt March in Narendra Modi's Gujarat. So, you know, that was also in many ways a political journey, you know, on the trail of Gandhi's Salt March. So that's a little bit about what I do. And I also teach here, and my courses also have to do with Hindu nationalism and the political documentary. Right.
So that's an interesting point to start with. So you have just mentioned it as political documentary. So some people might say that art itself is political. Whatever you do is political. Personal is political.
Right.
I have my own interpretations for it. But there is dialectically, scientifically speaking, there is something which we associate it with politics. For instance, it could be electoral politics or the ideology or the politics of image, what one can talk about. So if you can throw light on what it means for you, at least, something a political documentary.
So yeah, that's a very good point here. And I would like to say that, say, the political documentary course that we do, it's both about the overtly political, as you mentioned, it could be a film on an election, or it could be a film, you know, that discusses or critiques caste politics or Hindu nationalism, but it is also about the politics of form. So a new way of seeing, sometimes you might want to, you know, have a very different approach in a political documentary. So we also want to show films like this. I mean, just to give you an instance, your colleague, Mukul Haloy, for instance, we showed his film, you know, Tales from My Childhood.
Childhood.
So because it's formally, it's such an interesting film as well. So there the politics of form also discussed, right? So that's, but speaking of my own interests, I mean, you are actually just grappling with issues of sort of caste and communalism, and that has been an interest of mine. In the Salt Stories film, in fact, it's all these different issues sort of come together in the same film. But we can discuss the details and the formal qualities of these films later in the discussion.
So, for instance, you have mentioned about Mukul's film, like many people wouldn't have seen, but just to take the cue from there, you've talked about two things, which is the outright political matter, for instance, electoral politics or ideology, Marxism, fundamentalism, all these things. Other thing you mentioned is about the form.
Right.
So form, what do I understand of form? Like, obviously, we all know that cinema has shots and it's been edited. So how do I differently see a form in a, for instance, the Salt Stories, you have an idea, your politics is there, but how the form takes the shape of the same politics. For instance, what you also wanted to show some.
Yes.
So for instance, what would have been shot in a different way? What would happen?
Right.
So if you can get into that.
I will, Nachi, I'm going to just quickly share with you what some people are writing. Some people are just writing saying that the link is not working for them. So just double check on this front, please. They're just saying that whatever...
So the YouTube live is happening.
I see.
No, the YouTube, just that they should go to the channel, they will see the...
I see.
Live.
Okay.
That's all.
So it's the potato. It's very simple. Plus, right.
They go to the channel, then they will see the live happen.
Okay.
Nothing
I think
complicated, actually.
Yeah, I think at some point I'll send these messages.
Channel, they just
when we are screening something, I can just let the people know, right? I mean, some friends are just, they probably just didn't know where to go. Okay. But to answer your question, I mean, I think one way to do this would be perhaps to show a particular sequence. And also since what we are doing is we have called this, reimagining Gandhi in the age of Hindutva. Mm-hmm. I also do not want to just talk about the politics of form and sort of not really talk about what the films are about or what some of the scenes are here. And I thought maybe
I'm going to get there.
No, Nachi, I'm just saying maybe a good way to start is to show you something that's much more conventional in terms of political documentary, but an important scene in terms of the subject. And I thought I could show you about 8 or 9 minutes of the scene from The Men in the Tree, which is about the RSS and Gandhi. And then, but as I said, this is a fairly conventional style of political documentary filmmaking, and you may see something different.
Yeah, I think that's more apt for what we're talking, because we start from there, then we will get into something which is different so that we can actually sketch the difference.
So shall I just share my screen and we can maybe just start with...
Am I audible?
You are audible, yes.
Yeah, please.
So shall I just share my screen and can we see this excerpt from The Men in the Tree? Okay.
Please do.
Okay. I'll just ask you to just confirm that you are able to see the screen. Is this screen visible? It is?
Yes. Bhagat Singh's name is important.
Yes. Just a minute. I'm just going to enter full screen. And
just checking the video once again, as you told.
Yes, it's about the scene really is about the RSS and its relationship to Gandhi and how they talk about Gandhi. Let's just watch.
Yes, please.
Left front, please. They're just saying that whatever...
I'm not able to hear the audio. Lalit? Hello?
Yes.
The audio is not, I'm not able to hear anything.
Okay.
The audio?
You know, the audio is actually just coming from here.
Go to the left corner of the window. Can you just see original sound off on and share it? Please play it now.
The ban on the RSS was lifted after commissions of inquiry could not find evidence of RSS involvement.
Can you play it from before?
Yes.
Yeah.
भगत सिंह का नाम महत्वपूर्ण।
सरदार भगत सिंह वीर छत्रकाल और
ललित हेलो ललित ललित आई दे Lalit, can you unmute yourself?
Killing Gandhi was wrong.
Yes.
Yeah, the audio wasn't working for like after you muted yourself.
See, Gandhi was the worst thing that could happen to Hindu society according to ISIS. And this idea was fostered in RSS shakhas day in and day out.
हम लोगों को बताया ही जाता था कि असल में गांधी जी जिंदगी भर मुसलमानों से डरते डरते क्यों रहे उसका कारण वो बड़े ऑथेंटिकली गांधी जी की पर्सनल बायोग्राफी में पूछते थे और पर्सनल बायोग्राफी वही है कि उनके मुताबिक गांधी जी को एक बार उनके स्कूल के मुस्लिम छात्रों ने बहुत बुरी तरह पीटा था। चार पांच लड़कों ने मिलकर गांधी जी की पिटाई की। जाहिर है कि इन सब चीजों पर आप पूछ नहीं सकते कि आपको कैसे मानो।
All kinds of stories were told that Gandhi is tolerating abduction of Hindu women. He would not mind Hindu women being raped. He would not mind Hindu temples being razed. And he wants Hindu-Muslim unity at the cost of Hindus.
लोग कहते थे क्योंकि हमारी किताबों में लिखा रहता था कि गांधी जी फादर ऑफ द नेशन थे। आप जानते हैं कि इसको लेकर के पब्लिक कंट्रोवर्सीज भी हुई हैं। आरएसएस वाले इस चीज को बहुत क्रिटिसाइज करते हैं। शाखा के लेवल पे यह कहा जाता था कि अगर वो फादर ऑफ नेशन थे तो भारत के नहीं पाकिस्तान के। Gandhi was described as the father of the nation of Pakistan.
The idea that came to probably any Swayamsevak and to me personally, I thought I should not look at the face of this man. When I was put on duty to report his evening prayer meeting speech, I thought rather than going to the meeting and seeing his face, I will report it from relay on the radio, which I did. The only day when I thought that I will go there was the day when there was some kind of a talk in Hindu Mahasabha Bhavan that something very significant is going to happen today in the prayer meeting. So that day I went there. When a talk of something dramatic or something significant happening in his prayer, it could not be just a disturbance or a question being raised. It could be more serious. Because one of those days, a bomb had been thrown by one Madanlal Baba, and it was much worse than that. Before I reached Birla House, he had already been shot, and people were rushing out saying Gandhi has been murdered. So I did not have that opportunity of seeing his face also.
Mahatma Gandhi.
Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, Babasaheb Ambedkar, Rani Lakshmibai, Mahatma Gandhi. Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, Rani Lakshmibai, Mahatma Gandhi.
When some people came to Gandhi and said, they are very disciplined, dedicated people, Gandhi said, so were the Nazis.
They would not accept Gandhi's Hinduism. They would not accept Gandhi's nationalism. They would not accept Gandhi's non-violence. What did they accept? Gandhi's name. Killing of Gandhi was the first step towards formation of Hindu tribe. Just as the demolition of Babri Masjid has been described as the first step towards establishing cultural nationalism.
Okay, you've got the audio is okay now, right? So that was just one. I wanted to show that scene also as an instance of conventional kind of edited scene, on Gandhi and the RSS. We can talk about other forms later, but please, Nachi, you probably have a couple of questions.
So when I posed that question of form. Obviously, it is not to take away because today we're sitting here, not just because of the films. We could have done this event any day, but today we have placed this event majorly because today is Gandhi Jayanti, and especially Gandhi Jayanti today, when you have Narendra Modi going and paying tributes to him, where his photo, if you have seen the banners, You don't even see Gandhi's photographs anywhere. So it has become an absurdity. I think we can equate the same with RSS idea of India as well. For me, at least, Gandhi was India. Like, because I grew up in a very small town of Tamil Nadu, where if somebody says to me that, we live in India and this is independence, because all that is just concepts, right? Like, I've not seen the direct conflicts in my life. So for me, Gandhi was always India. So when we talk about RSS not accepting Gandhi, I think the idea of India, whatever it has been through Nehru or a kind of a secular, a sovereign socialist, whatever we call, all that is, I don't know how long it's going to be there, even in books. So do you also see it like that? The idea of Gandhi and the idea of India being parallelly getting destroyed?
Very interesting point. And Nachi, I just want to say, just check your connection, because there's a lot of static, I think, coming from your end. So, okay. You know, there's this, I think it's better now. Yeah. I think maybe it was the headphone cable rattling.
Maybe.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's fine now. No, that's a very interesting point. And, you know, one thing you notice, and I just like to share with you, I wish I could share an image with you, but you'll remember it. There's this image that suddenly proliferates. It's Modi at the Khadi Udyog Commission spinning the charkha. It's a classic image of how, and it tells you a lot about the narcissism of the narcissistic tendency that Modi has, where he wants to actually supplant Gandhi, he wants to take his position. I mean, everything from the naming of the stadium in his name to, you know, Central Vista and, you know, all these projects. It's about supplanting the Nehruvian vision and the Gandhian vision of India, right? So this is very much, it's not an accident. I also want to share with you, so my two films on the RSS, there's the Boy in the Branch from 1993, The Men in the Tree from 2002, but I went back to film again. And this time, actually, I was filming with Avijit Mukul Kishore. He did the camera work, and Pratik Biswas was the sound recordist. And we go and we film again at Vijayadashmi, which is the Vijayadashmi, the RSS Founders Day. We do that. So we go, and this time you have the chief guest, and this is what he says in his speech. He says,
This was when?
This we shot it. I haven't actually put it in a film or anything, but I showed this to my students. It was in 2016 that we went, and we go back to the same RSS characters, the same three characters we go back to. So the chief guest says something very interesting. He says, देखिए गांधी जी ने तो एंड आई ट्रांसलेट इन इंग्लिश गांधी जी ने तो नमक सत्याग्रह के लिए अच्छा काम किया थोड़ा बहुत काम उन्होंने किया ही डिड सम वर्क ऑन द सॉल्ट मार्च गांधी बट यू पीपल यू द आरएसएस डिड मोस्ट ऑफ द वर्क
ओके
नाउ इंटरेस्टिंगली मोहन भागवत इज नॉट सेइंग दिस एन आरएसएस पर्सन इज नॉट सेइंग दिस बट अ चीफ गेस्ट इज सेइंग इट एंड यू ऑटोमेटिकली सी हाउ द आरएसएस इज बीइंग रिटन इन the history books. The fact of the matter is that Hedgebar of the RSS had said the RSS is not formally going to take part in the salt march. He had said that. He said individually any Swayam Sevak who wants to join, I can't stop him. But the RSS is not involved. That is what the official history is. But now you have a chief guest who actually comes out there and says, well, Gandhi did little stuff for the salt march, but you guys were at the forefront, right?
So who is not even from RSS, right? He's not a Pracharak.
He's a chief guest now. I'm sure the RSS will say we never told him to say it. He said it off his own volition. But little by little, like this, a new history is being written.
Right? The same, right? Like they have never hoisted the flag until till they came to the power, like BJP. So now you have them beating up people for not sitting for national anthem. They were the people who never accepted the national anthem, right? So now you have them beating up people for not standing up for the national anthem and not respecting.
Or look at how Godse, Nathuram Godse is sort of becoming part of the conversation. Now today when Pragya Singh Thakur says, you know, Godse was actually not, you know, he's been vilified, and Narendra Modi says, oh, I'm very upset with what you say, but there's no censure. Nothing happens to these people. They can, you know, they can make anti-Gandhi remarks and pro-Godse remarks, but it's becoming more and more acceptable in mainstream discourse, you know. And in 2002, this scene I show you, the RSS is they've just come into power, right? But they're being very careful. At that time, you will not find these statements being uttered. You know, it will be a comment like, oh, well, Godse's intention was not wrong, his action was wrong, as Professor Rajinder Singh of the RSS says, which is a very ambiguous statement. But again, you know, it's your ideology is coming through, you know. What do you mean the intention was not wrong? Reaction was wrong. What does that mean? It's actually a nonsensical argument, right?
I remember because it was a very small place and we never had any kind of, even the whole, the new Hindutva, what we see today, when I grew up in my village, it wasn't even existing. The same with the kind of what you see with other kind of fundamentalism, maybe Jamaats and all these things rising up. All this happened post Babri Masjid. And we have, I come from, again, the static.
There's a lot of static coming.
Yeah. So, is it right now? Better?
No, it's still there.
Is the disturbance or what kind, like?
Static, tuck, kind tuck, of stuff.
Okay.
I think it might be.
Is it fine? Better?
It's still there. Now it's fine. I can't hear it. Say something.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not there now.
Yeah, good enough?
This is good enough, yes.
Just...
Yeah.
So that's the thing, like when, am I audible?
Yes, absolutely.
So that's the thing when but there were small shakas coming up. And this I would say, especially when Babri Masjid happened in Coimbatore, the area which is very, very close to my town, 40 kilometers away. There the entire thing started becoming worse because a bomb blast happened. It's a huge bomb blast, and I could see in my front of my eyes the entire thing being completely changed. Till then, I would, as he's telling, there is a cultural nationalism which was post Babri Masjid and post Gandhi. You would say the RSS actually making a statement for the independent India, that anybody dared to do any reform inside, and. And if you know, it was Periyar. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah. So it was actually Periyar had warned Gandhi of this. Like he very clearly said to Gandhi that he'll be if he continues to do this, and he'll be killed by a Brahmin, if not anybody else, because this was kind of a foresight.
Right.
But again, what I am very especially today's cancel culture, I wanted to talk about that also. You have RSS hating Gandhi and they have very clear reasons for it. But other side, you have the, obviously I'm critical of Gandhi too. Like that's not that I'm critical of everybody for instant. But you have people who completely discount Gandhi and like cancel him and tell that, oh, he's also kind of a soft RSS, oh, Baniya tha.
No.
There is no difference between him and Modi, and he was selling the nation to Tatas, all this stuff. So, I think, so how this is helping, like for instance, somebody, I'm not telling that, oh, if you don't accept Gandhi, RSS is going to appropriate him. That anyway, they're going to do. Like for Ambedkar, for instance, I like it or not, they're going to appropriate. I'm not even getting into the RSS part here. How do you see this kind of a culture, which is very, very, you like Hindutva, this is also a very growing culture, especially in India today. I don't know how much you're aware of this kind of a cancel culture, which is happening. Like you can cancel anybody here, like the Ambedkarites would cancel Marx and hardcore left people would cancel.
No, I mean, in fact, we look, I'm the first person to say that, you know, some of the things that Gandhi did with respect to caste, I mean, of course, he's upheld the caste system. I mean, a lot of it is egregious, you know, and but we also have to accept that he was one of the first nationalist leaders who fought against the practice of untouchability. And later on, in my understanding, at least, or my reading, you know, I was reading this book by David Cardiman, you know, where he sort of clearly documents how, you know, in the 40s particularly, some of the political positions of Gandhi and Ambedkar actually start, you know, coming closer, and Gandhi does pave the way for Ambedkar to become the writer of the Constitution. I feel sometimes this hatred of Gandhi is just that a lot of, obviously a follower of Ambedkar is not going to love Gandhi. I mean, you recognize the historical trajectory from where this comes from. I feel too much of this is done at the expense of not recognizing what the RSS is actually doing with Dalits, or how it's working with Dalits and co-opting Dalits to the cause. So it's almost like sometimes I feel that when I don't say this for everybody, but I mean, some young idealistic Dalit activists I meet have two major enemies that they talk about. One is Gandhi and Gandhians, and the other is the left. Because of the way the left has dealt with the issue of caste and let down the whole Ambedkar movement, let down Ambedkar, right? Ambedkarites. Not recognizing what the RSS is. It's almost like the Hindutva is then given a very soft touch. Oh, you know, they are not really threatening to us. Obviously not all, I'll just finish my point. Obviously not all scholars are like this. One of the most astute writers on this subject is Anand Teltumbe, you know, who then talks, because he clearly sees the moves that the Sangh Parivar has been doing with reference to co-optation of the Dalit.
If you have read the works of D.R. Nagaraj, the Kannada scholar, so he is right. Flaming Feet. That's another fantastic text where he criticizes Ambedkar also, and like he...
In fact, Hardiman refers to this text, if I'm not mistaken. He refers to this text by Nagaraj that you're talking about, if I'm not mistaken.
Teltumbe also kind of deals issue in the same way. And again, talking about the left, if you would say, they are also trying to appropriate Bhagat Singh, right? Like at the other end, right. Bhagat Singh was clearly a socialist, communist. He was reading Clara Zetkin's Lenin, I think a book of Lenin when he was going to be hanged. And you see ABVP having Bhagat Singh as their icon.
Yeah.
what more absurd it could get.
But, you know, to continue the point, what you were talking about issues of appropriation, there's some very creative appropriation of historical figures that's happening, right? So again, this is not something that's made into a film as yet, but just to share with you, a couple of years ago, just before we entered the COVID period, I was filming the anti-CAA protests in Delhi. So I was filming at Jamia Millia Islamia, I was filming at Shaheen Bagh. It was just like this is interesting stuff happening. I just picked up a camera and I started filming. But it's remarkable what those remarkable students from Jamia Millia Islamia, and also this was happening at Shaheen Bagh, at the forefront of this fight for Indian secularism, you have the father of the constitution, Ambedkar, and his great ally, the father of the nation, Gandhi. And you have the two of them leading, and then you have a whole pantheon of other leaders. You've got Maulana Abul Kalam Azad, you've got Bhagat Singh, you've got many, many other leaders. Nehru is one of them. You know, but at the forefront is always Ambedkar and Gandhi, right? So at least two, now you can say this is entirely symbolic, but these symbols have huge power. And I fully believe that this sort of, I mean, different communities getting together, you know, Dalits and Muslims working together, students from different faiths. There was a whole contingent of Sikhs that had come in and, you know, they were working together. The mainstream, the political establishment was extremely, extremely, extremely worried. Which is why, to cut a long story short, certain events transpired. And, you know, of course, you have the riots, and then you have the group that was actually, you know, not at all really doing the peacekeeping. This is the group that's been maligned, you know. You know the whole story. But this is very, very creative use of symbols that we saw the students, you know, at the forefront at that time. It was very inspiring.
Again, getting into the film, for instance, I would like to start with Saul stories. Like, though we saw the clip from Men in the Tree, like I would start with, because for instance,
ideation part. As a filmmaker, I'm posing this question for young filmmakers also. Okay, how do you get that idea? Like, okay, I know Salt Story has happened, and like I can make a biopic on Salt Story, which is what I can understand. But you take an idea which is obviously not, it doesn't just happen. There has to be some process. So if you can talk about the process of it.
Thanks, Nachi. Actually, you know, what happens is that the Men in the Tree ends with, we saw the sequence about Gandhi in the RSS. So that was something that interested me in any case a great deal, the RSS relationship with Gandhi. But the film, of course, ends with a kind of epilogue where the Gujarat riots have happened. And my attitude as a filmmaker is, oh no, not again, because of course, when The Boy in the Branch is about to end, I mean, we've almost finished the film, the demolition of the Babri Mosque happens. And I'm almost about to finish this film and the horrific massacre in Gujarat happens where, you know, about 2,000 Muslims have just been murdered in cold blood by the Sangh Parivar, you know. So this at the end of the day was, this is happening in Gandhi's Gujarat. This is happening in Gandhi's Gujarat. And of course, I'm not naive. I know that Gujarat is the one place where, you know, Gandhi is, you know, he's been over the years just reduced and reduced and reduced, because Gujarat is the place where the RSS is at its most powerful. You know, it's often, Gujarat is referred to as the Hindutva laboratory, right? So the idea from that period of time was, you know, I want to do something about Gandhi in Gujarat. I want to do something about Gandhi in Gujarat. And, you know, then it's a long process. I actually go, you know, I see a film at IDFA in 2002 where The Men in the Tree is showing, and or 2003 it was. And it's a film about a road movie. And it's a film called On Hitler's Highway.
Okay.
Very different film, very different film. But the filmmaker is basically traveling down Hitler's highway. And then from there, I came across a book by Thomas Weber, where he's actually just following the trail of Gandhi's salt march. And then, you know, the idea just hit home. I said, this is the film I want to make. Yeah.
Okay.
You know, and how, let's track Gandhi's salt march. And that's a way of talking about Gandhi in Gujarat. And then that whole period of course, research and, you know, that whole thing begins, and it becomes like this road movie documentary where we can't go to all the villages and towns that Gandhi stopped at, because he stopped, I think, at 48 villages and 6 towns. Yeah. We maybe stop at 2 towns and, you know, I don't know, 12 villages or something, because, or maybe even less, because we do it also, this was a coincidence, we do our journey in 24 days. Gandhi does his walk in 24 days, his march in 24 days. That was just pure coincidence. It ended up happening that way. Of course, we don't do, you know, first day he goes from this place to this place. We go to a village, we stop for at least 3 nights and we film there. Then we move to a next village. And a lot of it, Nachi, is by chance. Because you sometimes don't know, if you turn left, you'll go to one village. If you turn right, you'll end up at another village. And one of these sessions, I end up meeting the only survivor of the salt march. I meet this 101-year-old Gandhian at one of the villages, right? Yeah. So it's a lot of it is then just becomes a very spontaneous meeting of people on the journey.
Again, to touch upon the form, which is what you have. From what you have spoken, I'm just taking the cue. For instance, I'm planning a film on Gandhi Salt March, and I'm trying to make the film wherever. So there could be multiple ways of approaching. Like somebody would have made a docufiction, for instance, have somebody like Gandhi, and like he may go. Somebody can become like a Gandhi with makeup, and like he may go to the places. But you take a very different approach in terms of, especially from what we have seen in both the other films of yours, and there might be other films also between what I'm talking is between Men in the Tree and Salt Stories. You would have done other stuff too, right?
Yes.
There would have been other stuff too, but in terms of, obviously, like you have interviews, you have other things, and you clearly said it's a kind of a road movie where the kind of a sense of the travel is there. But the thing with especially with the kind of approach what you've taken with the shots the way it has been shot. And what we are talking before the live about Ranjan and Mrinal both doing fiction now. Do you think, two questions. One is, do you think the crew, for instance, Ranjan or Mrinal or anybody, even Reena who had edited the film, they should have some kind of a common minimum agreement in the ideology? This is one question. And the second question, how much of the input in terms of the theory part of the film, theory,
okay,
theoretical part of the film is needed for the technical crew? I mean, the camera person. These are two questions which I would want to.
Right. So to talk about the first point, I mean, I think I should, since you brought up the crew also becomes, in many different ways, the crew becomes very important in all these three films. And I'm just going to very briefly talk about this, and then I'll come to Salt Stories. So in The Boy in the Branch, I had the largest crew I ever had. I had 9 people. We used to refer to it as my Shaka. This was the wide eye film Shaka. I used to joke with the RSS characters. You know, it's very scary for a first-time filmmaker. I'm just saying, you know, you can have the gumption to write a proposal, you know, get through to the RSS. It's very scary to go into the heart of RSS territory. And I couldn't have done it without my team. You know, we were 9 people, my Shaka was there, and we used, you know, there was something about the strength of numbers. We had also had we had fantastic people apart from anything else, you know. Everyone sort of goes on to have great careers in cinema and art worlds and whatnot. The second film, in contrast, The Men in the Tree, could only happen because it was literally Ranjan Palit and myself, either Ranjan Palit and myself going and doing the shooting, or it was me alone. Because we were completely under the radar, you know? And the technology is also, it's a tiny camera, it's not 16 millimeter, it's like mini DV, you know? And you're able to go in, and RSS doesn't know this film is being made, you know? We get access, the individual characters give us access. With the road, with the Salt Stories, a very different kind of approach happens. And I'm coming to the idea of the crew now. It's the one place where we foreground the crew films itself. And the reason for this is, you know, I had asked Mrinal Desai to do the camera work. And one day I'm at the airport and Nachi, I've lost you. Can I carry on speaking or?
I've just muted my video. I'm just checking the comments.
Okay. So, you know, basically I meet Reena Mohan at the airport and she says, "Oh, who's doing your camera work?" And I say, "Mrinal Desai is doing it." And she says, "Oh, that's very, very clever of you." And I said, "What do you mean?" And she says, "Oh, because of the Gandhi connection." And I have absolutely no idea what she's talking about. And then she says, "Oh, well, you know, Mrinal is Gandhi's great-great-grandson." So I'm just completely taken aback. I had no idea. And then my executive producer, remember that the Salt Stories had a shorter made-for-television version called In Search of Gandhi. And the executive producer on that film, Ika Vekalati, says, "You absolutely have to film Mrinal Desai and do it quietly, you know, get his response to being a part of this film. You know, what does it feel like, you know, being a relative of Gandhi's working on a film on Gandhi, right?" So this idea begins. And then gradually we start filming each other and the whole team sort of comes into it. To answer your question, how important is the ideology of the crew in terms of making the film? I would say it's obviously nice to work with like-minded individuals, except what ends up happening on this film shoot is I discover towards the end of the filming that my production assistant is actually a believer in the ideology of the RSS. And so we end up having this on camera, we end up having this now and this argument, right? So to that extent, it's obviously nice where it could be very difficult, I think, to, let's say if my main person was a believer in the RSS or didn't like Gandhi, it would be extremely difficult to work with that person. But, you know, you can clearly have someone who's the production assistant who's very good at his job. He's a very professional person. He's doing his job for the shoot, but this is his private belief. So that doesn't really come in the way of the filmmaking. Then you said, I think the other question you said is, how much of theoretical knowledge do you really need in terms of the technical knowledge?
In terms of the crew, like the technical crew, how much they should be, for instance, how much should they have read Gandhi or all that other things? Because
that's a very good question. But you know, I think a lot of Minal's knowledge about Gandhi was, of course, some of it was read, and you know, but a lot of it was even stories that he had heard from his mother.
Mm-hmm.
You know, stories that were sometimes obviously very flattering, but maybe sometimes stories that were not, you know, that came from the family tradition, which also made you realize how much of a traditionalist Gandhi was, you know, like how he was sort of anti, towards the end, again, this changes, but there was a period of time when he was very anti-science, you know.
Yeah.
And you know, there were family members who actually kind of suffered because of this, because Bapu's, you know, we are not going to use Western medicine here, right?
Mm.
So there could even be stories like that that I would hear, but I don't think that that kind of knowledge was essential, you know, and a lot of it was okay, just decisions that we take on the spot. I mean, obviously the journey becomes important because you follow the trail of Gandhi's salt march. So we are going here, we are going in this direction. Minal also being the only Gujarati speaker on our team, you know, he was also the translator in a sense. So certain amount of knowledge of the salt march, its route, what we are doing, all this becomes important. And then the later stuff, I mean, it was basically me who'd, you know, I'd done my research on Gandhi's speeches, the speeches he gave at different places. We had made decisions we would stop at these particular places because really there had been a very important event that happened there, which we wanted to focus on. Or sometimes we knew that there was something interesting happening in this particular area in the present moment, that's why we would want to go there. So we took these decisions sort of collaboratively, oftentimes.
Okay. Another thing is about the access, which I am very curious about, which I ask all the political filmmakers. You must be aware of the film, Joshua had made on the killing of communists in Indonesia or Cambodia?
Yeah. The two films he's made.
Act of Killing. Right. You see the title card, it's everything is anonymous. Except for Joshua's name, all the other crew, the characters are anonymous. And here, obviously, you have the access. Maybe it was before BJP had come to power, and still we are not at gone to that extent in our country where people have to go anonymous. But be it be Ranjan, be it be Cox film.
Actually, again, that static is coming.
Yeah.
So.
Now I think it should be fine. Right?
Yeah, it's fine now. Yes.
So this access part is one thing which I want to know. Like there are twofold questions, and that is, how do you get the trust of even the so-called enemy, if I have to put it that way? Like, obviously, for filmmakers, we can't take such hard-on positions, especially when you're doing a film. But ideologically, yeah, we have such things. And another thing is about the ethics. For instance, you've made a film and, like, somebody could be in trouble. Like, for just speaking to you, somebody could be in trouble in their life and you might not even know.
Right.
Sometimes you might not even know.
Right.
And when you get to know it, for instance, if you would have got to know it, like in your life, how do you deal with this personally? Right. Like, how do you sleep it out?
That's right. So, you know, fortunately, to the best of my knowledge, nothing like that has actually happened with any of these films. But, you know, these are very good questions. So first, to answer your question of access, the time I made my first film, where I wrote a proposal for Channel 4 television and they liked it, and you know, I was commissioned to make the film. I wrote a proposal to the RSS, which was very similar, but it didn't have a vision. I didn't put the visual treatment section. So when I told the Channel 4 that this is what I think the film is going to look like, and I sort of imagined a scene at the Shakha, this is the part that was not put for the RSS. And I changed a few words. I didn't use the word communal indoctrination. I used the word socialization of the recruit. You know, for the there's few words like that. Anyway, basically, this was a period of time when there was one television channel and Doordarshan, and they would not touch the RSS. So the RSS was not getting any publicity. They were planning their big Ram Janmabhoomi movement, which of course we know a year later actually led to the demolition of the mosque. They were planning this. They were looking for financial funds from abroad, and they clearly thought that my film on the RSS would help them get access. So Sudarshan, whom I went and met, was, oh, we've been waiting to have this film made. You know, we really want a film made on our Shakha. So they sort of, but they could see even from that time that this guy is, he's not, and I would openly say I'm Hindu, but I'm a secular Hindu. Mm-hmm. You know, that's how our team would sort of present itself. We would go there. They very clearly knew we were not from the fold. They would constantly try and get us to join the RSS, to sort of do Dhwaj Pranam at the Shakha, to attend the Shakha, to play games. We would refuse. He said, we can't, my attitude was, we can't join the Shakha if you're filming it, right? Eventually, the whole relationship, I think they started getting suspicious of us because of the kind of questions we were asking. So for instance, one thing I was denied in the, we was actually supposed to get access to the RSS archives, the visual archives and so on. And towards the end, they just backed off. I mean, they didn't say no, but they didn't make it available, which is why if you notice in The Boy in the Branch, I make use of black and white shots. It's actually a kind of almost like a homage to the black and white archive that we were supposed to get, but we never got, right? So this thing is always there in terms of, and you know, then, you know, but in the case of The Men in the Tree, when I go back, I get a personal access. Now, Sandeep Shripad give me a personal access. So does Purushottam Patte, the third character. And the fourth character who does is Thali, who's left the RSS. So oftentimes there was a feeling with the RSS Swayamsevaks that there's a scene where they are so outspoken because they're so proud of what they do. They basically say that they were complicit in the demolition of the mosque. And they actually say that the RSS had a hand in it. They were handpicked to do particular jobs. Now, this is at a period of time when there's an investigation happening on the RSS role in the demolition. There's a criminal, the CBI is launching a case against the RSS. The Liebehan Commission is doing its work. And these guys have gone and they're so proud of the involvement that they come and they share this. So this is one point where I actually felt they could get into trouble. Because I, of course, was very happy to use this material in my film. And lo and behold, of course, by the time we come to 2016, they are really proud of that scene. Because now the RSS is in power and, you know, they probably said all the right things, right? So the other sort of concern sometimes was that, you know, Kali would be, they would approach Kali because he's sort of very secular and he's left the RSS and they would say something to him, but that never happened. You know, Kali is not in touch with the RSS is not in touch with Kali. So that's also okay, you know. So this has actually not happened in terms of, but you're right in the sense that some films can actually end up endangering, you know, the characters, particularly because it's such a small world that we now operate in. You know, the films are online or they are shown somewhere, but somebody can get hold, you know, of copies of that film. It's being broadcast somewhere else, you know. These things are there, and I think filmmakers have to therefore be extremely careful in terms of the material they put out there and sort of always think of the potential consequences of cutting a particular scene or having a particular character in the film. I'm facing something like this right now. I'll give you an instance. It's something I'm working on. I'm working on some a really violent series of incidents that happened in this small town in UP. And a lot of the people I've interviewed are people who've come out, very poor Muslim workers and laborers, and they've come out and they've identified the people who were behind these killings or these lynchings and things like that. And they just came out because the media was not reaching out. I was one of the first filmmakers who went to them. Now I'm facing a problem. If I show this, and let's say I approach, I don't know, Caravan or Scroll or The Wire, or even if I make my documentary film, if I show these people, they can get attacked, right? At the same time, what they are saying is just extremely important, you know, because they were there, they were eyewitnesses. So how do you cut this sort of stuff, you see? So what I'm planning to do is obviously I'm planning to use voices and I'm planning to use their voices in locations that are really far from where they were, you see? And I'm hoping, but there's always that, even there, there's that slight chance that the person they are talking about, this BJP leader, he's going to be able to identify that voice, you know? How do to what extent do you go, you know? Do you then sort of change the audio quality of the voice? I mean, these, do you just take that, the content, and do you put text? You know, obviously you're not going to give the name, you're not going to show the face. But these are important issues, you know, in terms of how media images are received.
So somebody had asked a question, Nabina Chakraborty. If you had to, hi Lalit, could you please speak about if you had to make Boy in the Branch or Men in the Tree in today's time?
Wow, that's a really good question. That's a really good question. I mean, I think the Boy in the Branch would probably have been made in a very similar way. Because I should also share that when I wrote the proposal, one of the clauses in that proposal was that, or when, you know, the RSS was, I think, threatening to, you know, they were getting suspicious of us. I said, why are you suspicious of us? I'm not going to the neighboring Muslim Mohalla. I'm not going to Mominpura and taking interviews there. I'm only making the film using sources from the RSS. And it's a, when you, you know, it's also a matter of you make a commitment, you keep to it, right? So actually, if you see that entire film is by and large used from RSS sources, except we knew, and my you know, wonderful researcher and ED on the film, Shudharvata Sengupta, had been looking at reading RSS texts. And we'd already planned that we were going to use Guruji Golwalkar's writings, interspersing the text, right? So the film takes that form. But the form is definitely, there is going to be no voiceover in the film. There's going to be no extraneous interviews, you know? So I think even today, if I was making The Boy in the Branch, we would probably have to take a similar kind of commitment. Today, what was also, I'm sure the RSS, if they are today commissioning a film, will want to see the rough cut. Hmm. So with The Boy in the Branch, they wanted to see the rough cut. Okay. And they put a lot of pressure, and I said, nothing doing. And I was actually sort of, you know, being very sort of low-key and low-profile where I was. Only a few people knew where I was editing, where I was living. And the word that was put out was, I'm editing the film in London, you know. But they were very keen on being part of the rough cut. And the second film, of course, to answer the question was, nobody even knew I was making the film. So I think if I was to make a film today, I mean, I really don't know what form that this film would take, because sometimes I'm also aware of the limits of a particular kind of, what do you call it, an agitprop type of film, or a, you know, expository kind of frame where, you know, as a voiceover where there are different, I mean, I question the possibility of the documentary film leading to social change. I mean, I certainly feel that social change happens, but it's invariably some very good people who take your film and then show it at different places and say, look, and, you know, have a GD or have an explanation, or, you know, are able to communicate the film. Yeah. So I'm not sure what form it would take. Certainly it would, you know, I think it's also, you know, sometimes the kind of comments that are made, like when I went back in 2016, frankly, a lot of what the RSS guys were saying, including the main characters in my film, including Sandeep, who believes in Gomutra, he believes in cow dung, he believes the cow is the repository of all goodness. You go and sleep next to a cow and cow dung, and you know, you'll live to be 105. You know, there's all this stuff. And then at the same time, it's completely uninformed kind of rumor mongering. Sometimes you can end up actually just making these guys look stupid. Is that a form I want to take? I mean, you know, you'll have mirth. People will look at this material, they'll start laughing. What does that achieve? That has to be combined with a sense of, oh my God, these guys are in charge. You know, they're in charge of science in this country. You know, the people who should absolutely not be in charge of the reins of government are the people controlling it now. So I don't have a definite answer in terms of, you know, what form it would take. Except I think maybe it would be a multitude of forms, you know, or one would really, I'd have to think about that, yes.
And very interestingly, if you see all the three films, like Boy in the Branch was shot in 16mm, right? 16mm film. So then you have Men in the Tree, which is video.
It's video and it's like really poor technology. It's mini DV technology.
Yeah, Betacam, you know. Maybe?
Mini DV.
Mini DV. Then you have Salt Stories, which is HD.
HD, yes.
High definition video. So can you just speak about how these technologies have in a way or other influence the kind of duration and the form and everything, because with 16 millimeter we know like everything is cost, right? Like you have to buy the film. With digital, right, obviously you have that advantage. And also another thing is about the change of the crew, how it, obviously one part is Miran is associated with Gandhi and like the other thing, but I'm purely talking in terms of the approach of how this has changed with due to with respect to technology,
right?
Both pros and cons, and also the crew, like,
right. So again, very good questions, Niels. So with 16 millimeter, of course, I think that film, the form it took, The Boy in the Branch, I think it's the one film that, because 16 millimeter technology was so expensive, every 10 minute can of film was so expensive. I think it was like 4,000 rupees or something in those days, which was a huge amount of money. You had to really plan your shots. So when we were actually sort of rolling camera, we even had something, I learned this from one of my BBC shoots. There's something called a strawberry filter. I would tell Ranjan, or I would tell Mohan, this is a strawberry filter, use the strawberry filter. There's no such thing as a strawberry filter. It just means you're not rolling camera. It was a cue to the team that roll sound, but don't roll camera, because we had to keep the notable RSS leaders happy and make them feel that we were filming them. You know, that whole thing was happening. So when do you film? That becomes very important. So for instance, if you see The Boy in the Branch, even the opening shot, this pan across the boys, we are going to do that. That was one thing. There's this scene with these old men where we know we have these slow motion shots. We planned that there would be these scenes and they would be like the pauses in the film. Pauses, almost like a transition device. We would have one of these scenes, A lot of planning. We knew, as I mentioned, Shuddha was already looking at the textual materials. We knew we were going to use Goldwalkar's quotations, So it was really planned to that extent. Now, Men in the Tree becomes this really, there's also the advantage of using a camera that's this small is you're not noticed. There's an advantage of mini DV technology being so cheap that you can keep filming, but there's a disadvantage. You're not so careful in terms of planning your shots. Right?
The reason for the length of the film? Because Boy in the Branch is, the length is, if you see all the three lengths, it's
right,
kept on growing. With digital, the film has become big.
That's true, but it's also, what happened was that we had, Boy in the Branch was a commissioned film.
Okay.
And there were three films that had been commissioned as part of a program called For the Glory of Ram. So I had a 23-minute film. Dev Benigal had a 23-minute film, which was on the Ram Leela, and Anand Patwardhan had a 12-minute film.
Okay.
So eventually what happened was they were able to extend the program by a little bit. And I Rina and I were very happy with, I think it was a 37, 38-minute cut, which we wanted Channel 4 to show. And they said, look, we're very sorry, but we can't because it's part of a magazine program. So we cut it down. Eventually, we were able to give me 4 minutes more. So it's a 27-minute film. That's what it ends up being. So that was it. That's one of the reasons why, it's a shorter format film. But yes, I had no constraints for the Men in the Tree. And Men in the Tree is also then a very ambitious project because you're both talking about the earlier film. So there's like the first two parts. The first part is about the making of the earlier film. The second part is about the demolition of the mosque. And stories that kind of circulate within the RSS and 4-3, what's happening to the branches today. And of course, then there's an epilogue as well. So the length sort of almost is dictated by the content or the whole sort of scope of the project, Sorry, you had another question, I think, about how the crew changes, right? And how that affects, right. So I had worked with Mrinal on an earlier film on Jan Natya Manch called Natak Jari Hai. So, we had worked well together, and then it wasn't clear who was going to shoot this film. In fact, if I'm not mistaken, I probably approached, I don't know, it was always a toss-up between someone like Mrinal or Ranjan. And Ranjan, in any case, I think he was busy with his own project. So that was established very quickly. So, you know, that option in any case was not there. And then, you know, Minal and I got talking. And of course, he doesn't mention anything that he has anything to do with the Gandhi family. But our times, you know, just got, and we worked well together. And he was sort of a friend. And he said, I'm coming on and you must work with Anita Kushwaha, who we've done many projects with, who'd also, I've heard, been hearing great things about her. And we just met and we just got along. And it was also that. And then Minal sort of brings it across his crew. You know, Paras is there. Mahesh Bhai, the van driver, is just somebody we meet. He becomes part of the team and we start working from there. There were two other people who were working for us in Ahmedabad. And they were basically RSS BJP people, we realized very soon, you know. And did we want them coming on as part of the crew? No. I mean, so they did some liaison work for us in Ahmedabad, got us to film at some venues, and you know, we parted ways there. But yeah, I mean, I think I've been really fortunate in terms of all the crews I've worked on. You know, there've been different people. There's even you know, working with Mukul and Pratik. You know, they just like, we really got along. You know, so it just really helps to have a closely knit crew. You know. And of course, with Anita and Minal and Paras and Bhai, we were also traveling together. We were living together. We were going from place to place, right? So it's like you know, 24 days you're on the road. So it just helps to really be a close crew. Yes.
So then I was just curious, like, what if you had to do Salt Stories in maybe 80s or 90s when the video and the HD wouldn't have been there? I think it would have been a completely different film, right? Like,
right, yeah.
In terms of, because you don't have the luxury of shooting, and then obviously 16mm is going to be expensive, and like it's a road movie, right? Like, yeah. So you have to shoot a lot in terms of. So you told that it was shot over 24 days, right?
Yes. Yes, it was, and this was a coincidence. I mean, it wasn't that, because Gandhi's march is 24 days, within 24 days. It's after the shoot, we realized, wow, we went on this date, we came back on this date, it's been exactly 24 days. And that's what his march was also. And of course,
we have a question where, how do I know, because if it is a fiction film, I know that there is a start and there is a climax, so I'm done with the shoot. So in a documentary, apart from the material part of it, like where I'm commissioned for a 20-minute film, so I have this much footage, all that is apart. Like, how do I know that, okay, I can stop shooting now?
Okay. When do I get to the great thing actually with the journey or the narrative arc of a film like The Salt Stories is it's pretty much decided, because the film will begin in Ahmedabad, because that's where he starts. He essentially starts his march from there, from the Sabarmati Ashram. So that's got to be one of the first few locations. And it will end, you can choose, it will either end at Dandi or it will end at Dharasana, because actually the salt march story actually carries on to Dharasana. The salt pans, where the salt pans are, and Gandhi is arrested just a few days before. So we, of course, end the film in Dharasana, you know, where we talk to this worker who's working on the salt pans, you know. Or it could end with Gandhi. So there's automatically a narrative arc, you know, and you sort of, you cannot, of course, Nachi, this is, I think it's making a lot of noise. You know, there's a lot of crackle. So of course, this didn't matter. This sort of narrative arc was the producers and the commissioning editors of the shorter film, they were oblivious to it. They actually told me, we want you to film in Bangalore and we want you to film in Hyderabad, because we want to see what Gandhi would have done in Information City or in Tech City, or how he would have dealt with computers. And I said, excuse me, but that's got nothing to do with the Salt March. The Salt March does not happen in Bangalore or Hyderabad, right? So to them, the historicity of Gandhi's Salt March didn't matter at all. And there was a lot of pressure I was getting to film in Bangalore or Hyderabad or somewhere, place where, you know, there's computers and stuff like that, and I flatly refused. But to us, over the course of making the film, this becomes extremely important, that you also sort of go, you know, you're filming maybe in Surat, then you focus on the speech that Gandhi gave at Surat, you know. or the speech that he gave at Dundee, right? So there's a natural arc there. In between what happens, the drama that happens, the stories that, I suppose a certain, we actually followed the chronological order, but there's obviously, sometimes you feel like, oh, you know, the story of Napa would actually be nicer towards the end. That's the, I'm going to show you all footage from, you know, that's, I'm going to show you that scene, but I may have liked to end it, but you can't. If you're truthful to your journey, you will try and basically follow the trail of the salt march, not sort of start at Surat and then come to Ahmedabad and then go to Dundee, and, you know. So there's a sort of narrative journey or narrative arc that suggests itself. Can I show you, is it okay if we just see a scene from, I'd like to show you the sort of my hit, my item number scene from the Salt Stories.
If I may. Please.
Yeah? Okay. So this scene is there in Search of Gandhi, and a slightly different scene, and it's also there in the Salt Stories. I repeated it because it was kind of a popular scene, but I'm curious to get your reactions. I'm looking for...
You play the video?
Yes.
And
then I have to share screen and
you play the video
first. Just will you put, there's a lot of crackle coming from your side. There's a lot of static coming from your side. Yeah. Okay. Can you see this? Nachi, can you see this? Okay. Nachi, can you hear me? Can you see this image?
Start.
Okay.
Yeah, I can see the image. Can you play for the audio? It's not audible, like original sound on.
Yes.
Napa gave us hope. It was the only village we found where people tolerated and even celebrated difference. There were no statues of Gandhi at Napa. But as we traveled further, we started to find a number of Gandhi temples. These temples were abandoned, and this Gandhi god was always bolted and locked and shuttered. I found so many statues of Gandhi that I began to give them names. Roly Poly Gandhi, White Blind Gandhi, Black Grinning Gandhi, Bruised Beaten Up Gandhi. Am I really Gandhi, Gandhi? My personal favorite was this one. I called him Hitler Gandhi.
Okay. Yes. So, yeah. So, you know, we had then for a long period of time, Mrinal and I would keep sharing, adding to our collection of Gandhi statues. You know, he would find someone from somewhere and send it to me, and I would share. So we actually had a real collection of, and the background, of course, being that you probably know that, you know, Gandhi himself had said he didn't want any temples in his name. He didn't want any statues. He was absolutely against the idea. But here, of course, you have these temples, but then no one can really almost decide what Gandhi should look like, you know, which is also a sign. And the way it's kept, it's also a big sign that points to the erasure of Gandhi in Gujarat, you know, in many ways. So, so this was part of the shoot was also, you know, going to a new place and finding an entirely new story. A story that happened in Dhaman village, for instance, was very different from what happened in Dabhan. So Dabhan, for instance, was a caste village. You know, it was rampant with communalism, you know, casteism. You could see the casteism. It was palpable. Then you go to Napa, where Napa is the village where the villagers actually remember Gandhi. It's a village which kept out the Hindu fundamentalists, the RSS and the BHP during the Gujarat riots. It's a village where Hindus and Muslims live in harmony. There's there are 18 castes, but there's interdining that happens. You know, there's even within some castes, there's marriage that happens between different caste groups. There's interdining. I mean, what explains this? You know, what explains this kind of development? So, later on in, I would also like to show you the scene from Napa. And I actually go on to make a full film on this particular village some 3-4 years later, and that's called Tales from Napa. I can actually share it with you because it's a PSVT film, you know, so just for your interest. But it's a remarkable story, you know, that this is a village in Gujarat where, you know, Hindus and Muslims are able to live together and keep out the, the Hindu fundamentalists. So every story, this is the challenge of the Salt Stories was, you know, it, depending on, you know, which village you went to, there could be a completely different story in that limited geographical area.
So I was just wondering, I was just seeing some comments, if there are any questions, like most of that have been answered already. So I have one last question, like if you can take questions, answers after that, but if there is any, but otherwise I have only one last question to ask. So two questions, if you can club it, because both are concerned with money. So how do I approach ethics in terms of the funds which come in, because sometimes we are also in the business of market economy where the films are being funded by different agencies which might also be funding RSS or other kind of activities. Mm-hmm. So for instance, you're getting a fund from Ford or Tata or any corporate for that matter, they would also be funding any CSR activity taken up by RSS. So how do I take, as a filmmaker, is that also your concern, where the money is coming from? That's question number one. Question number two is it in today's time too, like is it possible, for instance, I always have this question with writers, at least in Tamil Nadu, nobody is a full-time writer. Either you work in an IT or you're a government employee, or your partner is working, you have a house to rent, then you can be a writer. You can't survive just by writing. The same question I have it for filmmakers who are especially in this form of making, like documentaries. Because I know at least in fiction film, there is money, there is at least work. You can go and assist somebody, you'll gain money, all the things. But when you're in the business of making documentary films, especially you're not doing any corporate video or like you're not doing all that kind of stuff. So advertisements or so, These are okay. My concluding questions.
Right. Very, very good questions again, Nachi. Thanks for them. To respond to, you know, funding agencies and the issue of ethics and who you take money from, I think this is real. It's a very important question. And it's a very important thing. And definitely, I think you cannot... Firstly, I mean, you'd be compromised. If you took money from agencies that also funded the RSS, the contradictions would at some point come through, you know. And you could very well then have the funding agency turning around and saying, you know, I don't want this film made in this particular way. I don't want it made in that particular way. So definitely, you know, if you're, if you believe in secularism or you believe in pluralism or, you know, you're off the left or, you know, broadly that direction, you want to actually work with like-minded organizations. Now, I was very fortunate that for my first film, The Boy in the Branch was funded by Channel 4 Television, and there was a very enlightened commissioning editor in those days by the name of Alan Fountain. And the entire team, I mean, my executive producer was a guy called Anthony Shang, just a lovely guy. These guys remarkably just let me make the film I wanted to, you know? I mean, it's remarkable. I can't say the same thing for the Salt Stories film, In Search of Gandhi, where, you know, there were, that film had a very high profile. It was shown on 35 international television channels. And it sort of came with those problems because every commissioning editor wanted his say in terms of how the film should be made. And I'm sorry to say, I don't want to mention names. These people really knew nothing about India. So one of the series editor was telling me to read a book by Pankaj Mishra, which was on Gandhi. And I couldn't find a book by Pankaj Mishra on Gandhi. Then I find out that he's talking about a book that's about the Gandhi-Nehru family. You know, and each commissioning editor was sort of trying to impress the other one by, I found out later, oh, you know, Arundhati Roy will write the script for his film. No, I'm getting Amitabh Ghosh. All lies. You know, so I'm just saying that, but at least in terms of their political position, they were not supporters of the RSS, for instance. More than anything else, it was they had a particular vision of what the documentary should look like. So that was my problem with them. But not ideologically, I think it would be impossible actually. And similarly, Men in the Tree, the two organizations, I mean, I know television channel got involved, but you know, they were these wonderful organizations, the basically the equivalent of the Sundance Documentary Fund and the Bertha Fund. You know, the precursors to that had actually given me grants to make that film. So that's a very important question. I think you cannot get funding from, you know, some parivar organizations, obviously, for doing this kind of work, or even from corporates that fund these agencies. About the idea of writing and, you know, making documentary films per se, there's, of course, the famous quote by... you know, the Frederick Wiseman story where he's being interviewed by this student who just loves Frederick Wiseman's work, says, sir, you know, can you give me some tips? What do I do in terms of, you know, making my film? What tips can you give me? He says, and Wiseman just very dryly says, marry a rich person. You know, so that's his advice. But this is Fred Wiseman, one of the greatest documentary filmmakers and the most prolific documentary filmmaker saying this, you know. It's probably very sound advice, but no.
Hospital is my favorite of his.
Right.
Wonderful
right.
Film.
Wonderful. I mean, but there's so many brilliant ones, right? Titicut Follies is another brilliant film. His first film, in fact. But no, just getting back to this, you know, I think it's very important. I'm fortunate because Nachi, again, the static is happening. Sorry, I just want to... you know, I'm very fortunate that I get to talk about documentary films, show documentary films, but I also get to teach in, I think teaching is a very good, it's great if you can teach and make documentaries, for instance, or it's great if you have a skill, you're an editor, along with being a documentary filmmaker, or you're a camera person, or a cinematographer, along with being a, you know, documentary filmmaker. Before I sort of got into the teaching profession or got here, I used to work as a researcher and a production coordinator for the BBC. So that is literally where I would, you know, sort of get my salary, or I would work as a freelancer for maybe 3-4 months in a year. And then I would try and invest that money in making documentary films. So I think we really have to have alternative career paths as well. And this is also something, for instance, I tell my students, as in, you know, don't invest everything in this. I mean, even if you make, and I don't even know if the PSPT funding line is there anymore, it's probably not, right? So even that what would you do? You could at most make one PSPT film a year. Where does that take you, you know? So whether, I don't know, some people do corporate documentaries then. Some people get into advertising, ad films, just so long as you can just continue doing this work, which is your passion, you know, I think it's important.
So I told it was the last question, but I forgot to ask one important question, which we were discussing before the live, about the voiceovers.
Yes.
I always have this kind of a conflict, or you can say contradiction, how to bring in the subjectivity of a filmmaker. For instance, you talked about Weisman, like most of his films are observational, right? Like he doesn't bring his voice or anything, but again, by placing the camera, you bring in the subjectivity, by editing, you bring in the subjectivity. But where do you see the need for a voiceover? Is it a narrative tool or much more than that for you?
Right. Okay. So again, I'll just go back a little bit. So, you know, when I made The Boy in the Branch, I already explained how the formal style is dictated almost. Nati, again, I'm sorry, I keep pointing this out, but there's a lot of static. Yeah. Now it's fine. So, you know, because it was in the observational mode. It's also actually, in strange ways, a very interventionist film, because we know exactly where we are using Guruji Golwalkar's intertitles. It's going to come in at particular points. But the style, and Ranjan's style of filmmaking, is very observational, right? There's no voiceover in that film. Now, when I was screening that film, I had a very interesting encounter, coincidentally, or meeting with a person by the name of Ramchandra Gandhi. He's Gandhi's great-grandson, and this was at IIC. And, you know, we were chatting. I didn't know him, but very nice man. We had a very nice talk. He said, look, I really appreciate what you've done, but you should see this as a first step. What this film, the form does, it tells us something about the artists, tells us what they do in the artists' chakra. But you are in a position where you have information on the artists, and you're not informing us about the artists. At the information level, The Boy in the Branch, it does, and it's true, The Boy in the Branch is, you know, it tells you what happens at the chakra. It gives you visual cues, it gives you visual information. It's textural, it's sensory, but you don't really know that much about the RSS. So I think the form of The Men in the Tree is already decided. You know, when I decide to go and make the second film, I already know that I'm going to talk about the demolition of the mosque. I'm going to talk about the RSS and Gandhi, and the voiceover becomes all important. You know, in terms of the Salt Stories film, I mean, I think I just needed a thread to bind the film together. And also, of course, what happens is, in search of Gandhi, already a voice has come. The In Search of Gandhi, the shorter version, we had two voices. There was an actor playing Gandhi, and then there was my narration. And this one, I decided that I don't need that artifice. I will be, as the filmmaker also, there'll be a voice where I'm reading Gandhi, and then there's a voice. So I needed a sutradhar, you know, I needed a thread for this one. And I think it's a combination of an informational voiceover, and then it's also a personal voiceover at times, and sort of goes from one to the other, you know. But this is, I think, constantly a struggle. I mean, even now, I don't know what I'm going to decide, you know, with my next project. I mean, am I going to use a voice? If I'm using a voice, what is the kind of voice? Or should it just be observational? But of course, with this subjectivity, which is there in terms of the way you place your camera, what shots you use. I mean, the point of view definitely comes across, you know, even in that mode, yes. So Nachi, there's one other scene I wanted to share with everyone. And this is the village of Napa that I was talking about.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, and because it's also about remembering Gandhi, and in a peculiar kind of way, in this village, they remember Gandhi. Yeah. And I shudder to think what is happening to Napa today, because I went there last in, I think, 10 years ago, when I made Tales from Napa. I don't know what's happening now, but it's nice to remember that this was a village that came.
Yeah, please. I think it's a good way yes. to conclude the session also.
Yes. Okay, great. I'll just, let me just find a quick time and just give me a minute. Sorry, I need to share my screen, right?
No, you first play the video, then share the screen. Yeah.
Is it? Can you see this image?
Yeah, I can see the image.
Okay.
I can't hear anything. It's the same. Is the original sound on?
Walking. Gandhi is Napa.
Can you hear it?
Yeah. Perfect.
The region is involved in the kind of simple it is.
गुजरात में जब दहशत का माहौल था तो उसका जो माहौल था वो अलग था. ऐसा लगता था ये गांव पूरे गुजरात में नहीं है, यहाँ कुछ हुआ ही नहीं. हमारी कम्युनिटी ज्यादा है, हिंदू लोग है वो कम है यहाँ रहने, मगर वो उनको कभी ऐसा भी नहीं हुआ कि बाहर कुछ दंगा हो रहा है कि यहाँ हमें कुछ खतरा है, हमको मारेंगे, ऐसा कभी कुछ नहीं है. सब मिलजुल के रात को बैठते थे और हम उनकी हिफाजत करते कि कहीं दूसरा आके उनको ना मार जाए और हमारे नाम बदनाम ना हो जाए, तो हम सब मिलके उनकी हिफाजत करते. और आजू बाजू के गांव वाले सब मुसलमान यहाँ आए थे और कैंप भी रखा था, और ये कैंप में वो हिंदू लोग उनको खिलाते, वो तो ऐसे ही निकल गए थे दहशत के मारे, क्या लेंगे, बच्चों को लेके निकल गए. तो ये हिंदू लोग आते थे और उनके ओढ़ने की, खाने की, पीने की सब वो इंतजाम करते कि भाई हमारा भी फर्ज बनता है, आज इंसानियत जाग उठी है कि ऐसा नहीं होना चाहिए. और ये तो हिस्टोरिकल गांव है, गांधी जी भी यहाँ आए, गांधी कुछ किया, सब हिंदू मुसलमान सब साथ मिलके रहने का है, उसमें कोई दंगा फसाद नहीं होने की, ऐसी बात उन्होंने बोली थी. और हमारे जो बुजुर्ग है गांव वाले, तो उनका तो आदर्श है गांधी, हर कौन के, चाहे हिंदू हो मुसलमान हो, कोई भी गांधी जी को बहुत मानते हैं.
I was skeptical after meeting Ibrahim Bhai. How could Napa remain peaceful when Hindus have been killing Muslims in the neighboring villages? But then we met Kanti Bhai, a Hindu tobacco farmer. He confirmed that Napa was unique.
એટલે જે આપણી પંચાયત ઓફિસ કરી ને ત્યાં આગળ બધું ગામ સમગ્ર ભેગું કરેલું કે બીજી બધા ગામોમાં ગમે તે ઝઘડો થાય એ આપણે નહીં જોવાનું, આપણે આપણા ગામનું જુઓ કે આપણા ગામને બીજા ગામનું આવીને કોઈ ઝઘડો કરીને નાસી જાય પછી આપણે બે વળી મળીએ એ ધંધો આપણે નહીં કરવો. એટલા માટે બધું સંપીને રહેલું એટલા માટે ગામ ભેગું થયું.
પૂછે છે કે આમ કેમ છે અહીંયા, કારણ કે બાકીના ગામડામાં આવું નથી, બહુ ઊંધું છે.
અહીંયા પહેલેથી વર્ષોથી એકતા જ છે, અહીંયા 18 જાતના છે, કોઈ કહી ના શકે કે અહીંયા 18 જાતના છે, એક જ જાતિના માણસો એવું તમને લાગે, એટલે એકતા છે. બાકી અમારા લગ્ન પ્રસંગ હોય ને તો મુસલમાન બી અમારા લગ્ન પ્રસંગમાં આવે, નહીં તો આપણા લગ્ન પ્રસંગમાં આવે હિન્દુમાં તો આપણે એમનામ જઈએ, પણ અમારે એકબીજાને પહેલેથી એવો વ્યવહાર જ છે हिंदू कौन है और मुसलमान कौन है ऐसा कोई भेदभाव नहीं है, सब भाई।
परमात्मा जी इधर आए थे ना उसी टाइम पर, इसका उतारा इधर ही था और यहाँ बैठे थे और एक रात इधर रहे। और जरा भाषण करना थे, करने का हुआ तो बाहर गए थे, इसका मुकाम इधर ही था गांधी जी का। यहाँ तो ऊपर का भी टूट गया है, पहले नहीं था ऐसा, अभी टूट गया है, उसको जल्दी से करवाने का है, कराएंगे। भाषण क्या था इधर मंडप बांधे थे, गाजी बाजी रखा था, बाथरूम क्या था, सब लोग बैठे थे उसी टाइम पर, ये इस काम बैठने की जगह। ओके,
राइट,
या
राइट। सो यू नो दिस इज, आई जस्ट वांटेड टू एंड विद दिस, दैट द ब्रोकन डाउन प्लेस वेयर गांधी स्पेंट द नाइट, दिस इज नाउ बीइंग मेड इनटू अ वेरी ब्लैंड हेरिटेज साइट। आई मीन इट्स जस्ट वन रूम, इट्स जस्ट कैरेक्टरलेस, but they've been doing that over the course of the Salt March. Like, they've been developing a lot of these places and, you know, sort of it's this heritage and to promote tourism within Gujarat. I'm sure it's got the stamp of, you know, the Narendra Modi government and the BJP and all that. As you know, and you would know what's happening with the Sabarmati Ashram itself, as in, you know, there'll be a redesigned Sabarmati Ashram with not like the structure that exists right now. So all these plans are afoot, yes. But getting back to Napa, this is it was quite a remarkable story, actually, how this village resists the VHP and their calls. When I make that film in 2010-2011, we find out there's a blow-by-blow kind of thing where the VHP is sort of reaching out to the elders in the village saying, let us in, let our people come in. And these guys are just refusing to let them in. And, you know, there's this Shanti Samiti, this peace committee that forms that. So it just shows it's, you know, it's possible. And there are enclaves like this, even in a state like Gujarat, right? And really, it was a story of hope for us, you know, this village.
Yeah, I'll just quickly look if there are any questions from the
right.
People who have been watching this. No, I think we've answered the questions which have been there.
Right.
So, anyways, thank you, Lalit. It was a wonderful evening. I think nothing better could have been done, at least given the context of the pandemic and other things.
Right.
This was a meaningful way of remembering Gandhi.
Right. Right. No, thank you so much for having me here, Nachi. And I'm just sort of really appreciate the platform and, you know, what you guys do. And, you know, I just thank you so much for, in fact, showing my work and having this session with me. And of course, I don't know who's been watching, but, you know, thanks to everybody who's out there who sort of attended this session. And, you know, maybe you just want to say that the films will be available for, 2-3 weeks. So, you know, people sort of want to watch them on Nachi and Nachi's platform, the Potato Eaters Collective, they can tune in and watch the films.
Yeah, that's what I'm also, like, maybe we'll put up the mail ID or something where people can ask you if they still have questions, because another 2 weeks, the films will be...
Sure. Coming.
So maybe I can share you the... queries or any other observations, and it's quite surprising, though these are like cold in terms of when they're made and like, but still I could see many people commenting that they've been looking for this film for quite a while. Yeah. And like
yeah,
it was quite
I'm glad we're doing this. And you know, in I've got to find more ways of, you know, sort of making the films available. And I've just not had time, but there's sort of a start in terms of, you know, doing Hindi subtitled versions of the RSS films, which I'm hoping to find time at the end of the year. Right now, we are actually getting very involved with an online film festival that we are hosting at the Center for Modern Indian Studies. I'm going to send you the program, Nachi, so please publicize it. But we are busy with that right now, but I'm hoping there will be the Hindi subtitled versions at the end of the year. You know, we'll take the conversation forward. Okay, Nachi, thank you so much. Yeah.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much for people who have been watching. And as Lalit said, the films will be available for another couple of weeks. If any more queries or anything, then we'll be forwarding it to Lalit, and we look forward for having such meaningful events in future too. Thank you all. Thank you, Lalit.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Take care. Bye-bye.